So today the topic is Beethoven. We talked briefly. We mentioned Beethoven last week when we were having our first discussion about what the classical era was and what that meant, and the sort of the three major figures from that time period really are Haydn, Mozart, and Beethoven. Just so you know, actually, Beethoven, he was born in Bonn, which is in Germany, and then he ended up moving to Vienna, like everybody else seemed to move to Vienna, which we also talked about last week. One of the reasons that he moved to Vienna was because he wanted to study with Mozart. This was around 1791 or so, 1792, but what he had not expected, and what really nobody quite expected, was that Mozart had died. Mozart died at a very young age of 35, I think. So Beethoven arrived there and not expecting that Mozart would have died, but he ended up studying with Haydn. So there are certain connections between all those composers. Beethoven did meet Mozart at some earlier point when he traveled to Vienna. Mozart heard him, and the story is something that Mozart heard the young Beethoven and said something slightly quizzical, like, "This young man is going to make a great noise in the world," which I think he meant as a compliment. Anyway, in any case, I think Mozart was almost certainly, insightful enough to realize that this was one of the great composers, along with he himself, Mozart. Even at that young age, I think that was almost certainly apparent. So what I want to do is I want to show you a photo here, let me find it, of what's called a life mask. Let me see if I got this right. There we go, of Beethoven. And I think, the word life mask is used as in contrast to the word death mask, which is also something that people have done historically over the years, where they, after someone had died, they would put some kind of plaster. It's a little like making paper mache, or maybe like if you go to the dentist and they have to make like some imprint of your teeth, I think they put it on there and they leave it there. And then they take it off and they have this mold of your face, which is somewhat more accurate than a painting is going to be, to give us a real picture of what someone looks like. And a lot of our image of Beethoven comes not only from the many, many paintings that were made of him during his life, after his life, but also in particular from this life mask that was made. In this case, Beethoven was still alive. And I think a lot of people have ideas of his personality. They try as best they can to get some idea of who this man was based on looking at this. And one thing that everybody notices is that it just looks kind of like he's a little unhappy, at least a little unhappy. He's kind of scowling and kind of a little tense. And I actually saw not this original, but I saw a copy of it at an exhibit recently. And there was a note by it that said, it is possible, of course, that Beethoven's personality really was this kind of scowling and intense person, and that there's some evidence for that in the things that he said and the things that he wrote. But also, he was definitely, because by his own reports, extremely uncomfortable in the process of having this mask made, because they had to put this plaster on his face and then leave it there for an hour or something. He kept his mouth closed, pursed tightly, like as it is here, in part because he just didn't want that stuff to get in his mouth. And so I think he was just pretty annoyed at the process. So I just want to say that because so much of our idea of Beethoven is maybe limited by about what kind of person he was by this image of this particular mask. At the same time, I'm glad we have it, because it really, it's such a vivid, it almost makes the person, brings him to life. And it's easy to forget, I think, that people like Beethoven, anybody who lived before the era of photography in particular, that they were real people who did regular stuff like the rest of us in some ways. So as far as Beethoven's biography, I'm not going to go into too many details about that, but I want to mention a couple of things. The one thing that anybody seems to know about Beethoven, whether they know nothing else, they would know one thing, is that they knew that Beethoven was deaf. It would be a lot more proper to say that he became deaf, that he experienced hearing loss over the course of his lifetime. He didn't start out that way. And the thing about that is that it did actually have a direct relationship in some ways to his output of piano music, which is, again, I'll remind you, is the focus of our class, is about piano music in particular. Beethoven was a great performer. And so in the earlier part of his career, when he had no issues with his hearing at all, he wrote a lot of piano music. And the production of that piano music slowed down a bit as he started to lose his hearing, as he became aware of that. I'm curious if you can figure out why that's the case. Why would he write less? He didn't stop writing piano music, and he certainly didn't stop writing music. He wrote a lot of music, but why stop writing as much piano music when he started to lose his hearing? Any theories?
Did you ask why he lost his hearing?
No, I'm asking why the process, as a result of losing his hearing, did he write less piano music after that started happening? Okay, I know nobody wants to get the wrong answer, because you're all going to get in trouble for the wrong answer. Which is obviously not the case. So a reminder that Beethoven had these somewhat overlapping careers, but also separate careers in a way, as a performer and as a composer. And when he was writing piano music, he wrote it maybe for more than one reason, maybe for other people to play, but also especially for himself to be playing. And whereas when he wrote a string quartet, he obviously couldn't play it by himself. He was just writing music because he thought it was good to write a string quartet. But writing piano music was sometimes as a kind of a vehicle for himself as a performer. And whereas he could still, as we can see evidence of, could write great music without being able to hear it, being able to perform without being able to hear yourself was extremely difficult. And really, by the time his hearing got worse and worse, it was really impossible to perform well. So his motivation for writing piano music, one of the motivations for writing piano music, kind of went away as he lost his hearing. He still wanted to write piano music simply because he was interested in the genre. He was interested in writing music for the instrument, but the motivation of writing something that he could play himself was starting to disappear. And so we'll look a little bit later in the class at a list of the pieces that Beethoven wrote for the piano, and there's a significant drop-off at the time that he starts to lose his hearing, but there's certainly no drop-off in the amount of music that he wrote. He wrote a lot of music, just less focused on the piano. I want to share with you a document that we're not going to be able to read, but I'm going to read an excerpt from it that someone else translated. Let me find it here. It is that the right thing? Here it is. This totally illegible thing is what's known as the Heiligenstadt Testament, so-called because Beethoven, at one point, on advice from his doctor, traveled to a small town called Heiligenstadt, which is apparently about an hour. Well, in those days, it took an hour by coach or something to get from Vienna to sort of get out of the city. And one of the issues that Beethoven was suffering from is that he was finally realizing, this was 1802, when Beethoven was, I guess he was 32 years old, he was finally coming to grips with the fact that he was losing his hearing. And he wrote this letter to his two brothers, which he actually didn't send, he just put it in a drawer, and it was found later. He wrote this letter to his two younger brothers, expressing some of his feelings about the situation. And also, I believe that part of it, he might have had some explanation of, like, his will. It's kind of even the word testament there is like saying, okay, I'm going to leave you these things. That wasn't a big part of it. The main thrust of it was expressing how he felt. And if you can imagine, first of all, losing your hearing is inherently isolating, not being able to hear what's going on around you and feeling that much more alone as a result of that. In Beethoven's case in particular, it also made him feel like the very source of what made him important or worthwhile was disappearing. He's like, I'm a musician. If I can't hear, what's left for me? And by the way, this is in 1802. Beethoven lived till 1827. He had a good 25 more years after that, during which he was extremely productive, but he did question the purpose and the meaning of his life, his very existence. And in fact, I'm going to read you a passage that has been, first of all, translated into English, also translated from illegible into legible. But so he, I'm just going to read this, and you'll realize what impact that this was having in his life. It says, "What a humiliation when someone stood beside me and they heard a flute in the distance, but I heard nothing. Or someone else heard a shepherd singing, and again, I heard nothing. And these kinds of incidents brought me to the verge of despair. And just a little more, and I would have put an end to my life. Only art it was that withheld me. It seemed impossible to leave the world until I had produced all that I felt called upon me to produce, and so I endured this wretched existence." So put another way, Beethoven says that he even contemplated suicide. This was just impossible. He didn't know how he could continue with his life, not being able to hear the sound of music. And in fact, there are other places in this path where he says, you know, I was especially great being able to hear, and now I'm losing that. And so, but what held him back was the feeling that he had something important left to accomplish. And as I said, in the following 25 years, he did accomplish quite a lot. This letter written in 1802 precedes, for example, the symphonies number 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, the sonata, the piano sonatas, including the Appassionata, the Waldstein, the string quartet, so it was 59. I mean, incredible amount of music that, so thankfully, he did not take the rather drastic route of just saying he couldn't live with himself anymore. So, but this, it is in fact a big part of Beethoven's biography that he went through this. You may also know the very touching and sad story, supposedly, of when the Ninth Symphony was premiered. Now, I should explain that he lost his hearing gradually. By the time he wrote that letter, he could still hear, and he still performed, for example, a little bit. Gradually, over time, over the next 12 years or so, he got to the point where he really could hardly hear anything at all. But supposedly, by the time the Ninth Symphony was premiered, he was at the premiere, which you could say, like, what was even the point of him being there at the first performance of the piece, because he couldn't actually hear it. And what's a little bit odd to me is that apparently he was sitting on the stage and he was facing the orchestra. Again, not sure what the purpose of any of that was, because he couldn't really weigh in with the orchestra and say, oh, could you play faster or slower? He couldn't really tell what was going on. But apparently at the conclusion of the performance, they needed to turn him around so that he could face the audience and see that they were giving him a standing ovation for this, the first performance of this important and incredible work. So just to give you a little picture of how incredibly difficult it was, and the kind of force of will it took for Beethoven, instead of just saying, I think I'm just going to sit around in my rocking chair and maybe I'll read books. Not that that's a bad thing, but that he felt like, what I'm going to do is I'm going to continue to write music because I have to. That force of will, also, you could say, it's a quality I think you hear in the music sometimes. Put in another way, maybe this is a slightly different flavor of the same thing, is that he was extremely stubborn. Beethoven just would not give up on anything. Whatever he got involved in, he stuck with it. Now, I'm going to talk about that later, how that quality is actually a part of the music, where he gets attached to some idea and he will not let it go. So don't let me forget to talk about that, but I'm going to skip over that for now and come back. Let me talk about, I'm just going to show you a list of what are the most important piano works that he wrote. And let me emphasize that he wrote a lot of important pieces that were not piano pieces, but I'm just going to confine myself to this today, because that's what I feel somewhat qualified to discuss. So first of all, he wrote 5 piano concertos. All 5 of them are great pieces. Probably number 5 is the best known, the one that has the nickname the Emperor Concerto. One thing about those is that also in those cases, the first 4 of those come from the period of time when he was still hearing. As far as he knew, he was 100% fine and therefore performing a lot. They were really vehicles for his own, not only showing off as a composer, but showing off as a performer. The 5th concerto, he already was in the period of time when he was less capable of performing. That number 5 is the best known, and I want to play a little excerpt of it for a couple of reasons. First of all, I just want to make absolutely sure that you know at least a few minutes of this piece. But the other thing is that the performance, you know, it was about 4 or 5 days ago that I was trying to find a good performance that I wanted to share of this. And then in an unfortunate coincidence, the performer in this recording is Leon Fleischer, who died, I believe now 2 days ago, maybe 3 days ago. I heard about it 2 days ago. Who was one of the 20th century's and part of the 21st century's greatest pianists. You may know about Leon Fleischer. I had a brief opportunity to work with him at the Tanglewood Festival when I was in college. And I still, even though I worked with him very briefly, I learned an incredible amount. I remember very vividly many of the things he said. One thing you may know about him or not know about him is that sometimes after making the recording, which I'll play a little bit of you for now, he developed a problem in his right arm that doctors were not able to solve for decades. And so his career as a performer, for different reasons than Beethoven's, was shortened. Although in Mr. Fleischer's case, he played all of whatever repertoire existed for the left hand alone. He became the world expert on playing left hand music, but you realize there's not a huge amount of that. There were composers who wrote music for him, and what other pieces there were great. But anyway, this is a great tribute both to him, who was an incredible musician, the most sincere of musicians. And also, of course, I just want you to hear this piece. So let me find that recording. We're just going to, unfortunately, we can only listen to a couple minutes of it. Okay, so I hate to cut it off. Honestly, I would rather just listen to the whole thing than listen to me talking. But anyway, you can listen to it later. It's not hard to find. That recording just came from somebody put it on YouTube. Anyway, it's with Leon Fleischer and the conductor George Zell with the Cleveland Orchestra. I believe that recording is from the 1960s, if I'm not mistaken. It might be slightly later than that. I'm not 100%. In any case, oh, and by the way, somebody's microphone is on, so I'm just going to mute everybody. Okay, not sure where that sound was coming from. So, okay, so let me go back to that list of works we were looking at a moment ago. Great. So there are 5 piano concertos, all 5 of which are absolutely brilliant. And by the way, pianists are very spoiled, and this is true of all kinds of repertoire, not just concertos or is that we have so much more music to play than everybody else. For example, the violin has a large repertoire too. They have 1 concerto by Beethoven. Cellists, they have no concerto by Beethoven. So, you know, we just have way more than everybody else. So that's a great luxury. So then he wrote a number of pieces also in the form of a theme and variations. There's about 20 of them, but the particular highlights that I would mention to you are those three that are listed there, the Eroica variations. They're so nicknamed because of the nickname also attached to the symphony number 3, the fourth movement of which uses the same theme as the basis of a series of variations. So it's there's that. And by the way, when it comes to nicknames in Beethoven's pieces, there are lots of pieces that have nicknames because they're famous and they're easy to remember. Usually a nickname came about because of some publisher who thought, if I call it the Moonlight Sonata instead of the Sonata Opus 27, number 2 in C sharp minor, then people will be a lot more excited to like, they're like, oh, I want to hear that Moonlight Sonata. So, but Beethoven didn't give those nicknames, except in very few cases, there are some pieces that have some title attached to them, but most do not. So the only reason I mention that is that there's no shame in calling it the Moonlight Sonata or the Eroica variations, but just want to make sure that you don't feel limited by saying, well, it has to sound like Moonlight or it has to sound heroic. It might or it might not, but it's that somebody other than Beethoven gave it that title. So I just want to mention that. I'm going to talk in a few minutes about those 32 variations, but I also want to mention the Diabelli variations. They're the variations on a waltz by Diabelli. Diabelli was a music publisher and composer who was a contemporary of Beethoven's. And actually the story of that piece is there are 33 variations on one theme. It's the answer to a trivia question in case you're on Jeopardy and somebody says, and the answer is, this is the longest piece piano piece by Beethoven. And the question is, what are the Diabelli variations? Because they take about 55 minutes to play or to listen to. Well worth it, I can tell you. It's very strenuous for the performer. I have had the privilege of playing it a number of times, but not recently. It's been a while. Anyway, the story of those, it's a massive, massive piece. As I said, takes almost an hour to play. The story about it is probably not true, but I'm going to tell it anyway, because you know, don't they say don't let the truth get in the way of a good story, is that supposedly, I should explain, the original premise was that this Diabelli, this publisher, he had an idea as a way to like attract attention to his publishing company, which is that he asked a whole bunch of his composer friends to each write one variation on a theme that he had written, and that he was going to compile all these variations into a book that would then be published. And it was a kind of a cool gimmick, actually. And among the people who submitted one variation on this theme for this project was Franz Schubert, wrote one very beautiful variation. The young Franz Liszt, who I believe was about 10 years old when he wrote his variation. And then he asked Beethoven, of course he asked Beethoven to write variations. And Beethoven just said he was not interested in this project. And I think there were a number of reasons for it, but one of them was that I think Beethoven didn't want to just be one guy in a collection of a bunch of composers. He wanted to be the guy. But he started thinking about the theme, and he got kind of interested in the theme. And he apparently went back to Diabelli and said, well, how many people have submitted variations for this so far? And Diabelli said, oh, it's great, 32. And so Beethoven said, fine. And he wrote his own 33 variations all on his own on that theme. It might not be a true story, but anyway, it's a pretty good one anyway, that he wanted to show I can do more than everybody else put together. So anyway, that's definitely a great piece you should get to know. So I want to talk a moment about the 32 variations in C minor. We're going to hear an excerpt of it in a moment. The reason I want to talk about it is for a couple of things. You might notice that after the words on the screen that say 32 variations, it says W-O-O 80. Looks like it says woo. Like it's like a possible like Chinese last name. But what that stands for is without opus. And so then we have to back up to what does opus mean? Opus means that something was published. And so the opus numbers with Beethoven correspond to the order in which they were published. The first thing that was published, opus 1, is a set of 3 piano trios. Opus 2 is a set of 3 piano sonatas, etc. And in Beethoven's case, you can usually get a pretty good idea of what order everything was written in, because that was the order they were published in. In other words, like as soon as he wrote something, a publisher was interested in publishing it. He was very well known and very successful and popular. That's not true, for example, of Schubert, who we're not going to particularly focus on today, but the opus numbers with Schubert are all over the place because he just published stuff whenever he could, whenever somebody showed interest. But with Beethoven, you usually, not always, but you usually get a pretty good idea of the order in which things were written. However, sometimes he just felt something was not good enough. And he wrote and he said, I'm not going to give it an opus number. Most of the time, those are lesser pieces by Beethoven and we don't even ever hear them. But there are some exceptions where Beethoven didn't seem to realize that he had written a really great piece. And other people are very glad to hear it and to play it. And so one of those examples are these 32 variations in C minor. And so somebody, I don't even know who it was, made a list of these pieces and gave them numbers, trying to figure out, like, again, the order they were written in as a kind of a way of cataloging them. So every once in a while, you'll see a Beethoven piece with a woo number. And this is one of those. So I'm going to let you hear a little excerpt of it. And I think you will agree with me that Beethoven was wrong about one thing in particular, that he felt this piece was not worthy of the stamp of approval of Beethoven, but it's a pretty great piece. So we're going to hear a little bit of this. Okay, let me go back to that. Okay, well, you only heard about a quarter of that, but I hope that on the basis of that, you would probably agree with me and disagree with Beethoven that that was a piece that was worthy of public hearing, and that would certainly be true of the remaining 75% of that piece. It's a little bit unusual in the sense that the theme and the variations are each extremely short, so they don't even really feel like individual things that kind of all runs together. That's not typical of Beethoven, theme and variation. Okay, let's go back to that, the sheet we were looking at before, if I can get that out. So in a few moments, we're gonna be talking about the piano sonatas, which is really at the heart of Beethoven's piano music. But before we do that, I have a category here called miscellaneous pieces. And unfortunately my formatting came out a little weird, but anyway, underneath where it says miscellaneous pieces on this page, there are a decent number, not a huge number, but of pieces that are not sonatas, they're not variations, they're not concertos. And they include the pieces listed there. That piece that's called Rondo a Capriccio, that was the title Beethoven gave it. And some very enterprising and clever publisher probably gave it a much more interesting title that Beethoven did, The Rage Over a Lost Penny, which is a very evocative image. That's this piece. I don't know if you've heard. It goes like that. So it's a kind of a humorous piece. So anyway, I just want to mention that. He wrote three sets of pieces called bagatelles. A bagatelle is best translated as a trifle, something just not important. Nevertheless, each, they're all very short pieces, but where like he really distills so much music into a very short and small amount of time. He says a lot in a very short space of time in this. And then the Andante Favori, you can see there's another piece with a woo number. That piece I want to mention because that piece, what it was originally, was it was the second movement of another piece, but he replaced that with a different version. It's the second movement of the what's called the Waldstein Sonata, Opus 53 C major sonata by Beethoven. And the thing about that is that when he originally wrote the piece, this was the second movement, the second of three movements. And it's quite a long piece. Also, the first one, really long, and the third one, really, really long. And so I think Beethoven even could edit himself once in a while and said, you know, this is just too long. So what he ended up doing was replacing it with a much shorter movement, which is about a page of music called, it even says in the music, just introduzione, introduction, rather than, it doesn't even call it a movement. But but fortunately he wrote this piece, which was quite beautiful, and rather than toss it in the trash, fortunately we still have it, and it's quite beautiful. But if we talk about Beethoven, really the main sort of body of what Beethoven accomplished for pianists and for people who listen to piano music are the 32 sonatas. Every one of those 32 sonatas is a masterpiece. They're all incredibly great. So if you spend, you know, a year getting to know each one of them, you won't be sorry. I mean, there's just so much there, so much to know and to appreciate. Each of them also has its own character, its own personality. They're all different from each other. Earlier, I mentioned that there was some impact on Beethoven's output relating to his deafness. And basically, you know, people often talk about Beethoven in terms of three stylistic periods within his music. And it's a little hard for me to even to say without, I actually find that division to be a little bit artificial because he wrote, it's not like, he was always sounded like Beethoven and he was always developing and changing and it wasn't only in these three distinct periods. But those three periods do correspond to a couple of things. The so-called middle period begins around the time that he wrote that letter that we saw earlier, the Heiligenstadt Testament, the time when he realizes that he is losing his hearing and what a tragedy that is in his own life. And then the late period really corresponds to the time when he had almost totally lost his hearing and certainly to the point where he was not able to perform in public at all. That was really not an option for him. So, and the early period, the music often is perhaps the most reminiscent of other classical era composers like Haydn and Mozart. There's something, a certain elegance and reserve and refinement, not all the time, but that's more of a part of those earlier pieces than later when it gets a little bit more rough and more over the top, you could say, maybe. But anyway, the numbers out of the 32 sonatas, the first 20 are from that early period. So he wrote those again, thinking about that, of course he wanted other people to play them too, I'm sure, but he was also thinking about himself. As his own career as a performer was necessarily curtailed, he kept writing piano music, but at a slower rate because there was less motivation to do that. From the early period includes such nicknames as the Pathétique, the Moonlight, the Tempest, all, you know, famous pieces. And in the middle period, the Waldstein Appassionata and Les Adieux, which translate as the Farewell. And then the late period. One notable thing about the late period in Beethoven's music, actually, there's a couple of things I want to mention. One is that a lot of the music that he wrote, not only piano music, but also things, for example, like string quartets, he became really focused on writing string quartets during that last period of his life. And in a lot of that music, he often writes very, very high pitches. And there's some thought, not all the time, but that he keeps going like the very highest register of the piano, the very high register of the violin. Violinist, the first violinist in a string quartet is always going crazy when they play those late Beethoven quartets. And it's thought that it's possible that his hearing loss was sort of started from the low, from the bottom, and that towards the end of his life, he could still hear sort of high things, and he just wanted to hear something. But another thing that happens a lot in the late period is that he became really fascinated with Baroque music. I believe Bach was up there, but also especially Handel. He was really interested in Handel. And every one of the piano sonatas that comes from that last period, and lots of other pieces are like this too, they always include a fugue, which I can tell you that nobody in the classical era, if not nobody, they weren't especially interested in that anymore. They said, we moved on from fugues, that's passé, and also we don't really know how to do it very well, so we're not doing it anymore, but he kept putting them in there. He was like, you know, and part of the reason I mentioned that is that as this, he never stopped developing and working and trying and challenging himself. He didn't have to write fugues. He did it incredibly well, but it was something that he had to sort of teach himself how to figure out how to do this kind of music that was in a somewhat different style than what he had done before. So one thing about Beethoven that is different from pretty much everybody we've talked about so far was kind of his employment status, or I should say the way that he supported himself was a little different than everybody else. So just to review some of the composers we've talked about so far. Scarlatti, for his entire career, as far as I'm aware, was employed by somebody whose name was the Princess Maria Barbara, who was from Italy and then ended up marrying a prince of Spain, and they moved to Spain. So he was a very important employee, but she was his boss and he wrote a lot of music for her. Then we talked about Bach, who had a series of jobs. He jumped around from job to job trying to make enough money to support his 13 children. And then we had Haydn, whose main employer for most of his life was Prince Esterhazy in Hungary, who, again, he gave, I'm sure, wide latitude, but once in a while, Prince Esterhazy would say, Franz, could you please write me a string quartet for my brother who's arriving in 2 weeks? You know, that kind of thing. He would have these kinds of assignments for him. Mozart wanted to get that kind of a job, and then it didn't quite work out. So he said, well, I think I'm going to go it alone. I'm just going to make money by writing music and maybe getting commissions, for example, from an opera house that says, we want you to write an opera. Or he would get a commission for this, or he might publish something. But it was really hard for Mozart. In fact, as we know, Mozart unfortunately died not only penniless, he died in the red. Wait, is it the, that means you have negative, right? Okay, I couldn't even remember what the right term was. So he had less than zero when he died, financially speaking, despite all that he had accomplished. Beethoven was the first great artist like in music with like a capital A, where people just put him in the same category as the aristocracy or in a similar category. Nowadays, we can hardly remember. You would never, I don't mean to insult Princess Maria Barbara, whoever she was, but we don't really remember Princess Maria Barbara except her because of her connection to Scarlatti. And we don't remember, you know, the Archbishop of Köthen except that he hired Bach, you know. But in those days, those people were, the composers talk about were probably at a lot lower status than the sort of aristocracy who supported them. That was just in the process of changing. If you think about the period of time, Beethoven was born in 1770, things like in the United States, the Declaration of Independence, asserting that all men are created equal. 1776, we have in 1789, the storming of the Bastille and sort of changing sort of the balance of power in Europe. So those sort of aristocracy were kind of were on their way down, and people who were becoming famous for what they did, like Beethoven, were on their way up. And so I want to show you, as a matter of contrast, let me just find this. To compare and contrast, there's a letter from Bach. I can't remember who he wrote it to, but it was somebody, one of his employers, where he signed a letter, Your Grace's utterly devoted servant and most obedient subordinate. And I'm 100% sure that whoever that person is almost totally forgotten by any of us, but we all know who Bach is. But in those days, it was different. Whereas when Beethoven wrote a letter to the Archduke Rudolf, he wrote, he signed it, your friend Beethoven. Right now, part of that, I think there's two sides to that. One is that, in fact, Beethoven did enjoy a higher status in his lifetime than Bach did during Bach's lifetime, just because of the way society was changing. It was also because of Beethoven's personality, who was not afraid to say, hey, I'm Beethoven, you know. And so he knew it. He knew he was important. But that was a sort of a different attitude, where the artist was looked at as a kind of special person, as opposed to a very finely trained, respected craftsman. Bach was a kind of a great artisan and craftsman. Beethoven was an artist. Now, both of them were in the same category from our point of view nowadays, but during their lives, they were looked at in a somewhat different way. And when we get to the Romantic era starting next week, you'll see that that was really the way that people looked at the artist, was as a kind of a special genius who had a special status that was different from everybody else. And Beethoven was the first sort of that we can see. Well, first of all, he deserved being treated like a genius, but also it was partly that society was different, partly that his own personality allowed him to be looked at in that way. Okay, so in a few minutes, what I'd like to do is play a piece for you, which is I'm gonna play, it's gonna be the first time and maybe the only time during these classes where I'm playing something that I would have been playing for you live in person if we had been able to have our festival. You know, this year was Beethoven's 250th, it still is, it's the 250th anniversary of his birth. So many performing organizations had in mind to play tons and tons of Beethoven celebrating his 250th birthday. And that included, would have included the San Juan Chamber Music Festival. So I was going to play the Beethoven sonata called, that's nicknamed the Appassionata, on one of the programs. So maybe I will in the future, who knows, but it may be on Beethoven's 251st. That'll be the plan, I think. But in any case, for now, I'll just be playing it over Zoom. But I want to mention a couple of things. So I'm going to play the first movement of it. I mentioned to you earlier that Beethoven was very stubborn and that he would get focused on something and not let it go. And I feel like one way in which you can hear that in the music is that he, as a kind of a way of composing, would tend to get very, would have some musical idea, which you tend to hear at the very beginning of the piece or somewhere near the beginning. In this case, it's right at the beginning. And that, maybe the first four measures of the piece, everything that comes in the rest of the piece is related to those first four measures, in the sense that, for example, the beginning of this piece, and later on I'll adjust the camera. So some of the things that are jump out about the sort of that passage is that it has this really distinctive rhythm. So bum ba ba bum ba ba. So when he has later on in the piece, a part of the piece that has a very different feeling, he uses the exact same rhythm. And in fact, he just basically takes the theme and turns it upside down. There's also actually one thing that happens slightly after the first four measures is there's a place where he goes, he has this rhythm in the left hand, ba 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 ba. Later on in the piece, when he writes completely different music that sounds, he's still using that. So, he gets he's so focused on this one thing that he keeps using over and over in the piece. Now, I'm only gonna be playing the first movement for you, but I have to tell you that the other movements of the piece also take from this opening material. Everything in the rest of the piece is related to that. So for example, one of the things you heard me play at the end of the first phrase of this piece, you'll hear it again. It's basically what happens. The second movement, which I'm not playing today, I'm sorry, starts out like this. So he says, I'm gonna base something on going up and coming back down. It sounds like a very simple idea, but he hammers it home over and over again. The third movement, so you notice that it has a kind of what's called an arpeggio, basically. Dum ba da, dum ba ba, C, A flat, F. The third movement, slow it down. Which is the same as the beginning of the first movement. Anyway, I could go on and on about this because I'm not even sure I'm making it super clear because I'm trying to save time here. But what I will say, I hope that you might notice some of that as you listen to this piece by Beethoven or any piece by Beethoven. In fact, the textbook example, and I almost literally mean textbook because if you get a book about Beethoven, it'll always use this as the example, is the entire first movement seems to be based on ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. So he just takes some rhythmic idea and does it over and over again. And one of the effects of that is that it's as if the music sounds like it's all cut from the same fabric. It all belongs together in some way. At the same time, you can imagine if somebody repeats himself over and over again, it gets a little boring. But I don't think there's anything boring in this piece. There, he constantly has an incredible amount of variety of sound and emotion, but with that one thing that's always in common that makes it feel like it belongs together. Anyway, I personally think that that obsessiveness, when he got interested in some idea and he sticks with it longer than anybody else would stick with it, any other composer, is partly a reflection of his own bullheadedness, which was both good, mostly good. You know, I think that in his personal life, sometimes people got a little fed up with it. But he was a genius. He was Beethoven. He could get away with it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do what I've done the last two classes, and I have to do this switcheroo where I move, where I change the Zoom meeting to my phone so I can use my iPad because I need to use the music to play this piece. So that's going to take me, I think, about 60 seconds, during which time you won't see me. So please bear with me, and I'll set that up. Okay, are you guys seeing me and hearing me? Great, okay, so I did that right. All right, give me just a moment. I'm gonna find a better way to do this one day, but for the moment, this is what I've figured out. Thank you.
someone said to me, what is the perfect piece of music? That movement is it.
Okay, I'm a little out of breath, but I'm happy to hear you guys. If you have any questions or comments, I'm happy to hear them now.
Wow, wow, wow. That was awesome. Thank you so much.
Max, I've got a question for you.
Oh, you got it, George.
Go ahead.
This actually doesn't necessarily have to do with Beethoven, but what are some of the decisions that you make when you want to add a piece to your concert repertoire, and about how long does it take between the time you make that decision and the time you are ready to perform it in public?
Those are very good questions that are not easy to answer. But I'll give you a little bit about it. The first thing is, like, how do I decide what to play, basically? If I'm talking about solo piano music, then usually I don't have to think about anybody except myself about, like, what do I feel like learning or what am I interested in doing. Although there's also something where I think, well, what would go well on a program with something else that I'm planning to play? Sometimes I think about that. You know, you want to have a program that has some variety, or maybe there's a program that has a certain theme and you're trying to fit into that. I have to say that mostly what ends up happening is that, as far as me learning a new piece of music, I'm just like so, I'm so dying to play whatever that piece of music is that I have to get to. And then usually what I end up doing is, in a sort of career way, is I just sort of program it somewhere. I say, okay, I have to play that piece in Seattle, so therefore I better learn it. So there's that, so I give myself that deadline. In terms of how long it takes, of course it depends on the piece. And I will also say, you were very good about how you asked the question. You said, before I think that I can perform it, at least for the first time. Depending on the piece, but it's rare that it would be more than a month that I would need to be able to do that, at least like at a level that I felt okay about. However, I can also say that, for example, this piece, the Appassionata, I have played this piece for 25 years at least. And I still feel like every time I look at it, I'm like, oh, now I know how to play it. I didn't understand it last year, but now I get it. So I'm always sort of improving, and I hope, or at least I'm making changes. So it's a constant process of trying to keep growing and learning. But just to be able to feel like, okay, I can play it at a level I feel okay about it. Some pieces that I could learn in a few days, I guess. But this would not be an example of that. I mean, this summer, so the whole... my sort of coronavirus repertoire has been expanding quite a lot because all of my concerts were canceled and lots of things have happened. So I suddenly had time to learn music that I hadn't played before. So I have turned my attention to lots of things I hadn't played that I just wanted to play because I felt like it. And hopefully they will find their way onto a concert program at some point in the future. But those things, it depends. Sometimes it's a couple of weeks, sometimes it's a month. There's this one piece, the Prokofiev Sonata number 6, that I've been working on and off for about 5-6 weeks, and it's I'm getting there. So I guess it depends on the piece.
Thank you.
Kelvin, you go first.
This is both for Max and maybe even for Uli as well. I think I'm right in saying that Beethoven's name was Ludwig van, V-A-N, Beethoven. Then he moved to Germany. So what's the difference between van and von?
Well, if you want to linguistically,
I always thought that von in German, Uli, was sort of somewhere near the upper class aristocracy.
It is. It is, but definitely.
Beethoven didn't come from aristocracy.
Right. Well, and also it's a Dutch. It's the Dutch, yes. Version. Yeah. So it's, I don't know 100% for sure, but it is thought that he may have had aristocratic roots or wanted to claim them, and so added the von to his name, Ludwig von Beethoven, possibly. I'm not 100% sure that his brothers, for example, used the von. They might have just been, but they were like Johann and I can't remember the other brothers' names. And we had two brothers, and they, Carl. So I think they might have been Carl Beethoven, not Carl von Beethoven. I think he might have added it. But there was some reason for that. I think there was in his ancestry somebody, and he wanted to see him. But that person, that might have been like of a Dutch background, although you know, for at least a few generations, spoke in German. So that's my impression. I don't know if there's more to it. Yeah, Ludwig of Beethoven.
Must have been so hard with 30 already to be so hard of hearing and to be such a wonderful musician, and then it gets worse and worse. So his life, I bet, was very, very hard to live. I was wondering if you could say why he only wrote one opera, Fidelio?
That's correct. So I don't know for sure because that's not my world, but my impression is that it was just extremely difficult for him. He didn't feel so at home with vocal music in general. And he didn't write a huge amount of just dramatic music, like music where you have to attach a story to the music and words. He wrote some, but I just think it was not as easy for him. As far as I know, that's the only reason. But even though it was not easy, again, he just said, I'm going to make this work somehow. Even that piece has like three or four different versions of the overture. Like even that part of the piece he couldn't settle on. And all of them get played in concerts.
Max, I had noticed with Beethoven that his music is so strong and these strong rhythms and strong beats. And I, as an amateur musician, I always thought that maybe that was because he could feel it more, you know, with his losing his hearing, that those beats and that incredible strength was something he could actually more sense and feel than the notes. You're making a face that maybe that's it. I mean, we don't know, I don't think, do we?
I never thought about it. I mean, the only thing that might undermine that argument a little bit is that I think that the music was equally like that before he lost his hearing. But it's possible. I have to look and see if it was more like that. It's possible that it happened more. I mean, there's a very strong one of the markings, musical markings that Beethoven uses more than any other composer is the marking forzando, which is a kind of a very strong accent.
Yeah.
And he uses it, I would say, in order of magnitude more frequently than whoever the second most often person to use it is. He just uses it constantly, that marking. And there's a certain kind of accenting, and often in places that are surprising or shocking, places that you don't expect it, or places where it's like, I cannot believe he's still doing that. He's done it 7 times in a row. He's going to do it 8 times now. I don't know. I've never connected that with his hearing, but maybe. I think there's also part of it that is just a very forceful person, you know, and that's what kind of got him through his difficulties. And by the way, as far as the hearing loss, again, I'm not an expert on medicine of any time, but particularly not the medicine from the 1800s. But my understanding is that whatever caused that problem, I think it might have been like an infection or something like that, would easily have been solved today. You know, it's which is, you know, just puts another perspective on it, that it was just something that would not have been an issue nowadays.
I also enjoyed your comment about the higher notes, because in Ode to Joy, there's a repetitive E natural that is on a horrible break for altos that we all just suffer through, and we're just straining and our eyes are bulging out trying to hit that note so perfectly. And I just thought, only a deaf man would write that note for an alto. And it's like, it's there for a while. It isn't like just once and you're done.
So I have to tell you about Beethoven, and because the question was asked about, like, you know, Fidelio and why only one opera. I think that he just wasn't like totally at ease with the voice in terms of like what was comfortable for it. I would also say that it was part of Beethoven's nature not totally to care about what was easy for people to do. He says, if you can't do it easy, he just didn't care. There's a story, again, this is another one of those stories that may or may not be true, but it's a good story. But even if it's not true, it illustrates something about Beethoven, which was true, which is that, so in the case of the violin sonata, which is nicknamed the Kreutzer sonata, it starts out with a passage that's incredibly difficult for the violinist, although it's absolutely part of the standard repertoire. And, you know, a concert violinist absolutely plays that piece and doesn't think twice about it. But when the piece was originally written in something like 1805 or so. I don't know the exact year, maybe around 1800. Apparently the violinist who was supposed to play it at first, he said to Beethoven, he said, you know, Mr. Beethoven, you know, this is unplayable. Can you, you're going to need to change this because a violinist can't play this. And the story, maybe not true, but still it's illustrative, even if it's not actually factual, is that Beethoven supposedly said, do you think that I care about your stupid little fiddle when the Almighty speaks to me? And, you know, the thing is, there's some truth to that because the performer's technique catches up to what the composers ask of them. And so in Beethoven's case, the thing is that if some other composer, lesser composer, had asked the altos in the Ode to Joy to sing something that was so incredibly difficult, they probably said, well, we're just not doing it. But, so, but in the case of Beethoven, they say, we're just going to have to figure out how to do this.
Well, I have a choice about it. That E natural is there for quite a while. It's not just once.
But what I mean is, like, another composer, people would just say, we won't play that person, we won't sing it. Oh. But like, we'll deal with it, I guess. So.
Sarah, if you like repetitive notes, you should try the first movement of Beethoven's Seventh Symphony. He goes on for hours with the same note being repeated over and over again.
Depends on if it's in your range or not.
Yeah. Well, great.
Max, I was wondering, Sarah's argument about Beethoven's dynamicism and, you know, bombasticness, how does that explain Beethoven's second movements, which so often are this very calm, relaxing, you know, almost a relief from like the first movement of the Appassionata?
Well, sure. I think, first of all, I think that there's a lot of power in the music that he wrote at times, and other times when he wrote music with great lyricism, he covered like the whole range of human experience, I think. Of course, it is through his own personality, but his personality also had more than one side to it. So I think Beethoven was capable of a lot of things. It is true that actually some of the most famous pieces, or the pieces that people seem to remember by Beethoven, are often of the more dramatic and type. But the thing is that there's a huge variety of music written in a lot of different ways. So he absolutely covered the whole range of, as I said, the range of human experience, I think. So that's just, there's different sides to him.
But he was just the master of playing off one feeling against another, because it would be so boring to have the whole symphony being the same feeling every single movement. That just would never have been interesting.
Yeah, so there's a term in music, it's a just Italian word, the subito, for example, subito piano or subito forte just means to be suddenly soft or suddenly loud. And or like immediately. And so I know that the time when my teacher, when I was a kid, had to tell me what that term meant was in connection with a piece by Beethoven, because he will very suddenly do something completely different. And I think that's part of the drama. That happens sometimes in a short space of time, in other ways over in a larger sense, that there's one movement of a piece will be very different from another movement of a piece. And so I talked earlier about how I think that the fact that he uses these sort of musical ideas that are kind of, it's like the DNA of the piece is in the first few measures of a piece usually, and then he keeps repeating some of those same ideas. That gives it a sense of unity, and that's good. But on the other hand, also the incredible amount of variety within a piece of music, often because of the range of expression. Those two things are what balanced out, are some of why Beethoven's music is so compelling, is those, it's both unified and varied, with maybe for different reasons and in different ways, but it has both of those qualities. So, well, great. So I'm sorry that we can't celebrate Beethoven's birthday the way that he deserves. 2020 is turning out to be a less than fantastic year, but we'll hopefully try to make up for it in future years. Beethoven, of course, it's not like he's neglected every other year, so he'll be doing okay by missing his 250-year celebrations. But well, it's great to see all of you, and thank you for your questions and comments. Next week, we'll start to talk about the Romantic era. And it may, I don't know if you have this feeling, you might not, but when you looked at the schedule, like, there's going to be 8 classes, it's going to be a lot. And now it feels like, wow, how do we cram so much stuff into so little time? So that's how I feel. But sailing right along, we've moved on. We're going to talk about Schumann and others starting next week. Yes? Oh, did somebody say something?
I said great.
Oh, great. Oh, you sound great. Okay. All right. But anyway, it's great, great to see you all, and I'll see you hopefully next week.
Have a great week, everybody.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.
See you next week. Okay.